Welcome to the Compton Weekly Editorial with your screaming host and ranting man with the rolling R's.
Tacos con mucho chile.
gRITZ. With a Z. And as I like to tell everyone and so forth, this is KTNG860AM.org. And please note, all opinions and views shared on this program are just that, in the editorial portion of our program. KTNG860AM is a nonprofit broadcast media center and news agency that reports of the subjects that are affecting your community. Our website is KTNG860AM.org. We are the American militants on the digital dial, the Ebola virus of corrupt-ass Compton, and the boot-to-asses crew to antagonizing racism in this country. And so we start with our man, our chef, our tour de force, our anti-slurpy.
Slurpee? Oh my goodness. How awful.
Takeaway tacos.
All right. Mira, I just finished writing my latest column.
What is it called?
For Whom the Bell Tolls at the Compton Unified School District.
Ooh.
And this is what it's about. On Tuesday, August the 12th, not too long ago, at approximately 5:15 p.m., at the twice monthly Compton Unified School District forum meeting, President Mika Ali called a meeting only to have it adjourned in about 10 minutes. Can you imagine that? And he immediately gavels to reconvene for, get this, as usual, a closed session meeting behind closed doors, as always, to exclude the public in attendance who had just arrived, and many were just arriving, only to be told, your voice does not count here. Now, these closed meetings are always, always Mikaka Ali's scheme, you know, by him and his fellow gangster thugs, who use this as a standard operating procedure without taking into account the consideration for the would-be participating community present. And these are taxpayers too. Now, what happens is that him and his gangster thugs, Charles Davis, Sky Fisher, the Slurpee, what we call him, the scuba diver?
The scuba diver.
Right.
The man from Uncle.
ouch. Is it facing down or what?
You heard of the dirty old uncle in the family, huh?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he's the dirty one.
All right. And let's not forget, last but not least, the non-voting member, school superintendent, Devon Brawley, who tends to use this tactic as everybody used, the four amigos, which I call them, they tend to use this tactic as a ruse to completely isolate the attending general public or the audience, which are, again, taxpayers in attendance, from taking part in the democratic civic progress. Now, what happens is this. The so-called public servants, they want to prevent the public from knowing what these out-of-the-control members are conspiring to fulfill their own special interests. They have no qualms about ignoring the public voters who are publicly outspoken and critical of them at their meetings, as long as benefits their own nest egg on a personal level.
And therefore, having witnessed, now I got a record. I'm 3-0. I've been through a coup, a fight, and a rumble, a riot, damn near riot. But here's the thing. While we were sitting in there, okay, I took pictures of board members and other personnel and so forth loafing around on the job, but this is what the taxpayers are paying for. It seemed to me, at a personal level, that I'm watching this, okay, go down, that the school board members, okay, were kind of somewhat divided in the way they approached and dealt with the people. Remember, while we were there, there was a case from the NAACP, which is charging them, the Compton Unified School District, for hiring park officers as regular duty school officers to walk around with M16s, but yet still there is a system of abuse of power by these police against students and some students who are mentally challenged.
And they're minors. I mean,
they're minors.
They're not gorillas. They're not Al Qaeda.
Yeah, you know, and there lies the problem. It's like the lady. Okay, Paulette Gibson. Yes, okay. She was basically there. She only had 3 minutes to speak. And then the attorney, Eric Morris, got up, and he only had 3 minutes to speak. But they have so much more they wanted to ask. But that public forum was only shot down to, what, two people? Only two people of their importance that actually got up to speak. But you
never
signed
answered.
Your name. You signed Maria's name, and you guys never got a chance to spoke. But as far as President Gibson and Eric Morris basically getting up there to speak and asking questions, they never did get any of those questions answered. Because why? Everybody decided to go in the back to adjourn.
As always.
A sequester. Now, mind you, listening public, that during the sequester and so forth, Tacos, Camus, Julia, and I were just basically hammering away at Swerve. And,
I had some more about him.
Oh, yeah. Mr.
Scuba Diver?
Yeah, the Onion Sucker. Onion Sucker.
That's a new one for me.
Hey, I make this shit up when I go. Basically, we're going to dig in.
hey! Watch it. You might make a Sky Fisher drool. Okay.
Oh God, jeez.
When you say that word.
Jeez. Not the case. I can pay some bums on Skid Row to beat his ass. $5 and a bus token. But here's what happened. Zacos, Camucci, Chili, and I were basically going through the crowd and so forth, saying hello, passing our cards, you know, presenting, you know, what we do and so forth. And unbeknownst to us, and for some reason, something said, you know, come on, let's go outside and take a breath of fresh air. So got brought you to the front door, and guess what we saw? Catering.
Oh, yeah.
Catering. 4 big ass buckets of food.
And you know what's the irony?
In a bag.
But you know what's the irony of all this?
Oh, what irony could it be?
Yes. Okay. The 4 amigos, look, I'm excluding the 4 women members because I have no problem with them. You know, God bless their souls. You know, I never had any problem with them.
Yeah, of course.
The 4 amigos, okay, they are on record. They're
racist. They don't like Mexicans straight out.
Right.
Let's call it right down the freaking middle here.
Okay.
All right. They're racist. They're straight up institutionalized racist with a title, and therefore they don't look at the statue of where they're working at. They're not sharing. They're not equal in sharing the power.
No, but see, they've forgotten. See, here's the irony of all this.
Willie Lynch.
They're still in the plantation mentality. They never left the plantation. Their mind is still yes, massa, you know, or si patron for some of the Hispanic sellouts that he's got there, you know. Black and brown plantation or hacienda mentality still pervades at the Compton Unified School District. And the thing about it is that they still they think they're so white Americanized. So they are copying their white slave masters mentality. And these babosos, black and brown, in their school district, you know, they haven't gotten out of the plantation.
Well, there's the problem. See, there's only like one brown person. He's in high school that represents that board. Everybody else is just black as I am. Okay?
No, it was before. He's not
it
there
was
anymore.
Before, but yeah, but now what we're dealing with right now is probably one of the most corrupt systems available. Now, after the food in the catering truck basically came in, we're going to find that catering truck, whoever the hell that was driving it, okay? The funny part was this. After, okay, you guys like, you're going to love, if you like laughter, you'll love this one. After the food was delivered, the trays and everything was delivered, okay? We basically circumvented the whole incident to one Lorraine Cervantes.
You did?
Oh, yeah. And I told her that, yeah, you know, that they sequestered back there and they had a whole big old tray of food, four trays of food and a bag of chips. And, you know, they had enough food for an army.
And you know what else? One of the aides that sat on the side tables, mm-hmm. From the board, he was the one that went to the driver, picked up twice. He made two trips, as far as I know, and took the food. So apparently, where was the food going to, if not for them?
But then we have the issue. 3 hours.
And a half.
3.5 hours of just sitting there. And I'm scratching my hemorrhoids on this one, all right? We're sitting there for 3.5 hours, okay? Lorraine Cervantes is just going, and she's just like, you know, if you give her, if she's like, you know, if you give a motherfucker an inch, they'll take a mile. She's one of them, okay? So she took that, she ran that all throughout the whole room the entire time. So by the time the door finally creaked open, who's the first person that you saw come out of that doorway after that sequester?
Charles Davis.
And Charles Davis came out.
The sexual harasser? No.
It gets even better than that. Now, Charles Davis comes out there, right? And Lorraine Cervantes is clear across on the other aisle with the other old cronies and so forth. And she goes, "Hey, Charles Davis, I heard y'all had food back there." And he's like denying the whole thing. He said, "Yeah, you had enough for an army. We've been sitting here for 3.5 hours. Y'all didn't bring us no food?" Quote, unquote. Of course, Charles Davis scuttled back and forth. But there was one particular person in particular who, from the beginning of the outset of the entire meeting to the time she left out of there, she had one distinct look on her face because of one issue and one issue only. And that was Madam Zaria. Uh-huh. And thus, needless to say, she rolled out of there. As a matter of fact, people, we'll be back after this. We're going to take a quick break and we'll come back after this, all right?
Are you coming back?
No, not yet. I mean... Oh my God.
Okay, just let me go and just let me get on to Slurpee and you can have the rest.
Where we are in this whole thing is that as we come out of the sequester and so forth, and by the way, Douglas Camuccatilli was doing a very offensive job in badgering and so forth and whatnot. And everyone's gonna know you cannot badger a bullshitter, okay? It just doesn't happen that way. But as we get ready to leave, as everybody's been sitting there for 3.5 hours, Madam Zarita comes out and so forth, and she is like in total, like, not having it mode. She was not having it.
I knew there was something wrong with her because I know Miss Zarita, Miss Sandra Zarita, she's always the jovial, happy-go-lucky, and when I saw her, I knew, and I had a gut feeling that, no, that's not my lady that I'm used to seeing.
Yes.
I don't know, there was something was not right.
Yes.
And sure enough,
Because
she confirmed it.
Yeah, because no sooner did she left, about, what, 5 or 10 minutes afterwards.
After the closed session meeting.
After the closed session meeting. The few that came out. Now, Mae Thomas, everybody loves Mae Thomas because she is down with the people. She's down with the people.
Oh, man. I love that lady.
Now, the rest of those idiots, what Charles Davis said was an acronym of how much idiocy. Power does not need... When you have an idiot with power, you have a very good chance of somebody actually saying that they're smart. Okay? All right? There's a very good chance of that. So when you have these idiots in power, then there's a premise for their next operator's modi, which is, okay, we didn't have a whole bunch of Mexican food. We got the itis.
We don't like Mexicans, but we like the food.
And therefore... We're going to dismiss the entire evening and we're gone. Bye-bye. Here's Charles Davis. I mean, he is the quote-unquote community saboteur, if I'm allowed to say that. He's a community saboteur because, for one thing, in his actions denote how much of an idiot he really is. For example, when he made his way to the stage the first time, and to let, you know, to basically just go back and forth and let people out of the door, and people were coming out of the side door and going out the side door and so forth. You know, only Mae Thomas went out to speak to the people because she's like, you know, she's down with the people and everybody loves her. Okay? She said quite emphatically that I'm down with the people because they put me here.
And she was the only one that stayed when everybody left.
Everybody left.
And then after that, she came to the people.
Oh, yeah.
She came to the people, to the audience.
We had Charles Davis come running out, and then he goes back and so forth, because at that same time he's going back, Lorraine Savarges was talking about all that food he's had and everything, and I said as soon as he walked past me, pretty much to the effect, quote unquote, wow, that must have been a damn good burp, just like that. And what, as soon as he gets close enough to like Eric Boyer, he's like, he's doing a Jenkins, like, who said that? Oh my God, it's like a flustered rooster.
I know.
When you put vinegar on his fucking face.
And not only that, don't forget, as he was leaving, I blew it. You know, I just went, well, went ballistic.
There's a reason why you would blow.
I told him I was going to expose him in other words, I declared war on the four amigos. I told him that I would do everything and everything in my power to expose this corrupt four amigos. And that's what I intend to do. So anybody out there got any information on this four amigos, to, you know, with facts, bring it on to me. And trust me, I know how to cook a good meal.
Oh, yes. And hopefully it's not fried in about 6 gallons of grease. But nonetheless... Hey, look.
You use grease and salt food too, you know?
I'm sorry, but like Sydney 48, I don't eat watermelon.
Okay.
All right. But more or less, from our girl Zarita and so forth, Miss Satra Zarita, she had a very pointed reason for leaving out of there. She did, because obviously when they came back, they read the counts and the votes on, okay, so we have a resolution on such and such item. Satra Zarita voted nay, everybody else voted yay, and then there was another issue that they all said they voted yay on.
And they never exposed it.
They never said what it was, why it was, who it was, where it was. Okay? Now, this goes to saying and so forth, the only reason they left out of there because, needless to say, Montezuma's revenge. They ate Mexican food and from Charles Davis's own mouth, people weren't feeling too well. You ate too damn much and you didn't feed anybody there.
And there's another theory also.
Theory?
No. Yeah, Slurpee. Davis and the rest of the gang, you know, they knew that we were going to ask about Sky Fisher. Who? By the way, according
Slurpee Sky Fisher.
Right. Stop it.
Slurpee Sky Fisher.
Stop it. Anyway. By the way, the people in the Compton community,
yep,
they added an extra C to Compton Unified School District.
Slurpee?
No. Now they know the CUSD with an extra C. It stands for Copulators Compton Unified School District. And in honor of Slurpee, a.k.a. Sky Fisher, who is also a known racist. If you go to if you go to Sky with two Y's, S-K-Y,
Why?
D. Fisher on YouTube, he also said about something about the faggot bitch Trayvon Martin. Remember?
Oh yeah, oh yeah. See, Sky Fisher, you can't spell KY jelly without your first name.
And that's what he said about Trayvon Martin. Mm-hmm. You know, and then he made a racist remarks against Mexicans. So obviously, you know, anybody serving on the board from the four amigos, Mikali, Charles Davis, Slurpee, Fisher, and even Darren Broadley, who's not an elected official, they all must be replaced with people that have the interest of the community and the children. How can the children of Compton look up to the school board when they have a sexual predator in their midst in the city?
Well, it's real
in
simple.
The city and the school board.
Real simple. First of all, Sky Fisher got caught out there. Okay, he got caught out there.
He got arrested by the federal marshals.
He got arrested by the federal marshals in San Diego. Okay, and why? Because like J. Edgar Hoover, baby, he got caught out there in some compromising positions from my reporting resources. Okay, so therefore, there are pictures floating out there of him. He's been blackballed, blackmailed, and so far silenced on the board. He can't say anything in front of the public, which only means one thing. He has to take the fall, and if he does, he's going to be sitting on the sideline collecting a pension for 5 years, people. Come on. Look at this. Look at the stratus of how this thing goes. If it falls downhill like that, the police department can do the exact same thing whenever some rogue cop gets into trouble. So therefore, Sky Fisher, the only reason why you are still sitting there in blame view of your the public that you serve is the only reason why the public that you serve has not thrown stones at you, eggs, rotten bread, frogs, dead salamanders. I don't care, dude. You're foul. You're nasty. You are the dirty uncle in the family. Okay. As a matter of fact, we have here. Okay, you know, not reason to believe or without a shadow of a doubt, we have it for fact. The only reason why that sequester took 3.5 hours long is because it was on your ass.
But not only that, you know, in the community, you know, they think that Ali feels threatened by this fact of life, which is why he has never trusted the Latino community of Compton. And the reason why he does not have a good working community relationship is because of his open arrogance, racism, and outright aggressive bigotry.
Who's that for? Mikali, or are we talking about Sky Fisher?
No, well, all of them really, but I'm focusing on Mikaka. I mean, Mikali, you know. Ali likes to brag that he has a good working relation with the Latino community, when in fact, he is the most despised Compton, quote-unquote, elected official by Latinos, you know, including many of our black brethren within the same city. So many of our black brothers and sisters, they feel the same way. But as for those few handful of bound paint job Hispanic hang-along coattails, eyes, and are the coattail eyes and ears, you know, they're nothing but leeches that are found in his immediate surrounding midst. They are nothing more than what we Raza de Barrio described as Mikaka Mikali's beck and call brown, step and fetch it, yes man, don't say us, bola de perros lambiscones, which means had main boot licking dogs and more.
Okay, so back to the subject at hand about Sky Fisher and the reason why there was a sequester. In Ms. Satra Zarita's own words,
By the way, she emailed it to us.
She basically sent this in herself.
Right.
Okay, quote unquote, she says, I don't think we should continue with quote unquote business as usual. I believe in the criminal justice system and that a person is innocent until proven guilty. However, these allegations have become a great distraction, and I believe Mr. Fisher should take a leave until this very serious matter has been resolved. Our graduation rate is up substantially. We have 5 California discriminating schools, several blue ribbon schools to watch, a positively certified budget, and many other significant accomplishments. I certainly don't want this matter to overshadow the great progress we're making in the Compton Unified School District, unquote, by Ms. Satra Zarita, Compton Unified School District Board Member of School Trustees. So therefore, people, that lets you know right then and there that Sky Fisher is above all, is not above all reproach. However, as a elected official, just like they did that trick, whoever he is, the trick down in Texas, Perry, he got indicted. So can you indict this guy Fisher?
Governor,
there has to be a solution to the problem instead of dragging the problem all over the floor just to make an argument out of the situation. There has to be a solution, and that solution is real simple. Get rid of his ass. Indict them. Have them sitting before, you know, call the IRS. Call the IRS. Don't be afraid to pick up the phone. The problem with people who sit by and let shit happen is because they're too afraid to step forward to do it.
Look, if Texas Governor Rick Perry is going to get indicted, you know, according to the news sources, I don't see why this pendejo's four amigos don't get indicted. Okay?
Because it's the same thing I've been saying. All right? People are afraid to come out of their houses unless something tragic or dramatic is happening, because they're so desensitized for what they see on TV and for what little they do for do care about their own community. There used to be hoods back in the day. It's all about the community. So therefore, people, if we can find a way of indicting this person, it's real simple. Get out there and lobby for it. Do not go through the circular train of command that is basically ruining Compton as it is. Go above their heads. Don't be a schmuck following the rule to example. We'll be back after this. Holy smokies. Holy smokies. Go, go, go. I have planned this myself. We're going into this right here. Okay. And in 3, 2, 1, and we're back. What is a scapegoat? By biblical definition, it simply means to offer your child to God as a blood sacrifice. Of the 400 killings a year nationwide, cops do it all the time. Doesn't matter if you're a woman, be it your hands are up, handcuffed, or you're walking down the street just to get a gallon of milk. As heard by millions across the country, as one pig put it, quote unquote, we're animals. As J. Rudy Damager asked, who rapes and ravages and calls us savages? It's the same in Australia, a divisive trait of racism that marks the chaotic near extermination of the black man. The paranoid and psychotic disposal of the brown and the lynching of the red in nonprofit sports franchisement. But at what cost and to whose benefit? Half the time, one half of us is too damn lazy to do anything but party, bullshit, and bring babies into sins that plague the redundancy within the community as ignorance, while the other half is too busy blaming the former for being too ghetto, while they have their noses in the air, waiting on someone to save them in the process. Another group's claims were too docile. too docile in the American nightmare with aimless revolutions that are forged in bloodshed. But ask yourself, who's doing the most spilling of this near attempt to Negrocide, brown cleansing, red erase? Idiots far and wide from the POA, Police Organization of America, have made it a crusade to demonize the future existence of the sanity lost in America, a nightmare. After all, the more things change, the more they stay the same. Think about it. Obama lame ass has been in the redneck house. He's been nothing short of a house Negro with very little sympathy for black youth. Sure, he can sign laws like Brothers Keeper, but can't keep his own in Chi-Town from killing each other. I mean, what? 87 dead during the 4th of July. Makes the St. Valentine's Massacre look like a damn picnic. Oh, my bad. I shouldn't have used the slave master's wording there. You know, picnic. Picanini.
Picanini?
Picanini.
Oh, God.
Okay. So you get my drift, Mensos.
Okay.
From the disgrace of Lil Weezy, a.k.a. Lil Wayne's misguided reference of Emmett Till's, to cite operatives who instill fear into the black community, one has to ask, are we this damn complacent? Maybe in L.A. as a whole, but certainly not in Ferguson, Missouri. Historically, as a people, we've made some strides at the cost of a national purge, a right, if you will, of our basic rights as human beings. To dwell in a free land that was stolen to begin with is a contradiction to the ideology of democracy, no matter how fallible the concept. Where every other race that has cried foul, reparations have been made and paid, in some cases still paying into a welfare state of Zionist religious racism that is infused in ideology. Should we stop consuming the grift of Che Whitey? Stop paying taxes into a system developed by the banking genesis of Britain and France, and stand in defense of our person, commit to an armed revolution that needs to happen, stop acting like feral coons on a leash called matricidic oppression, and bust a cap in that ass of self-doubt, fear, and prejudice against your own. Develop a civilian review board against law enforcement, check your sucker-ass state officials, and their attorneys who are paid under the table of justice against corruption, and you just might have a clean slate to start a utopian existence. Across this country, thousands have rallied behind the cold-blooded murder of Mike Brown. It took a minute, but even after, the cops are still abusing people, if not bringing the military hardware used against Palestinians. What the hell? We sold them that hardware, idiots. As the monster mind is now automating the news from the Associated Press, how does fabricating evidence constitute legalizing murder after the fact? How did Mike Brown grow an additional 6 inches, steal 2 blunts, ran, change clothes, and his sandals just to be a profiled victim for a blood sacrifice to a nameless devil called justice? Why do dumb people of social status vent their racist indignations against black and indigenous cultures on social media thinking no one would see it? And by chance, somebody else will repost that crap opinion, letting everyone know that your crazy bitch wife is just as racist as you, Sheriff. Oh, do we dare hold these responsible for moral code in which they should be more moral upstanding, or should the contradiction or contradictional or conditional practice of corporal punishment be met with armed resistance? Should we go out blazing or should we be lazy?
What was the news headline you saw on the Spanish language newspaper the other day?
Oh, that's right.
Even in the Latino press? Yes,
even in the Latino press it said, Afghanistan in America, caca.
And equals Ferguson?
No, it just says Afghanistan in America. And it showed the guy sitting on an AT-GAT on top of a machine gun, a 50 cal at that, Mob Deuce. You know what a Mob Deuce is, right? Okay, he's sitting on there with his helmet and flag jacket on. I mean, come on. Leavenworth, Kansas. You're next to a military prison. Where else are they going to put their military hardware from?
Well,
it's the cheapest place to do it.
Well, I got news for you.
Uh-oh.
Okay. First of all, let me go up here first. You know the pig, I mean, whatever, that murdered Michael Brown?
Uh-huh.
Well, it come out that his name is, Darren Wilson. But here's what they
say. No relation to Pete Wilson, huh?
Could be. But see, here's what they say that he was an exemplary police officer. But he,
can you explain exemplary police officer?
Well, this is my take that I wrote to the public when the article came about him being a good cop and the Yahoo News.
Spill it.
Okay, and I wrote the following. You know, first of all, this is about the person, Ferguson, Missouri, about Darren Wilson, the white cop, how he was a nice person who had earned the police honors before the shooting. Well, this is my take. Yeah, right. That's how white crack American pig's daddy, his father, is covering up for his murdering son, Darren Wilson. Sob, sob, sob. Oh, my son is a nice, gentle person and wouldn't hurt a fly. I said, boo hoo hoo, sniff, sniff. Oh, shut the fuck up. You know, and had the roles been reversed, and this, I'm quoting this because I wrote it, you know, had the roles been reversed, black cop killing white racist cracker and deservingly so. Trust me, folks, even the chief of the pigs in Ferguson would have fired him right there and then on the spot and had him persecuted without question and imprisoned.
Ooh.
So the hell with you, Ferguson whitey cracker bastards, including you murdering pigs. And I say the chickens are coming home to roost in Ferguson. Burn, baby, burn. Power to all black and brown people in occupied America.
But even still, there are... See, this is the one thing that the news does not report or tell you of the alliances that are happening. Of course, across the country, people have had their silent protests in Chicago, in New York, in Florida, and even in faraway places as far as Iowa. What they don't say that's happening in Missouri is that there is a Chicano movement that's with the people about police abuse.
Enlighten me.
Enlighten you indeed, homeboy. Yes, even though there is a small population there, Mexicans pretty much in the South are just as far off pegged, okay, profiled, if you will, profiled just as bad. And they're profiled in a different way. They're profiled in the same way. They just want to know where you're from, what you're doing. And that's usually a profile. That's the first question. The second time they come around and so forth, it's like, all right, get your hands on the hood of the car. I got a question. You let me search your back.
Paper, please.
Oh, yes, indeed. I mean, I thought I was in communist Russia.
Well, let me tell you, interesting you say that, because a former Israeli Defense Force combat soldier.
Israel.
Okay. From Zionist Israel, you know.
1.7 million Jews are causing problems to 990 Muslims.
Let me tell you what I wrote in my Facebook. And by the way, if you people out there want to read my columns, you know, I can write better than I can speak. Okay? Go to capital E, period, small F, period, Mohammed, M-O-H-A-M-M, two M's, E-D, Martinez. And you can go there, you can find my writings there. But anyway, here's what I wrote. You know, listen up, my oppressed brothers and sisters of occupied white supremacist America. This is a must-see and listen video that should and must be concerned and must concern everyone in the struggle against American racism and fascism. That's why I want you to go to my Facebook, you know, so you can see this. You have to see this video. Okay, the militarization, and this is important for you people out there to know, the militarization of this fascist nation is underway more so than ever before in American history against all people of color, color, immigrants, and freedom fighting street protesters and those who do not look like them. Our national white racist police forces, the arm of white nativist isolationist privileged Americaners, is well aware that their days on this continent are numbered, which they have resorted like when cockroach is sprayed on them as they run for their very own lives and shout, "Raid!" On this video, and you should look at it, you are about to see the former IDF combat soldier document how much of the members of the police departments in America, you know, are being trained at the war criminal Zionist Israeli military training camps. So, bottom line, most of the police department cadets and personnel are being trained in Israel. I always knew this was going on for decades, but it was not until I heard this former IDF, you know, Israeli Defense Force, confirm my long-time suspicions. My colleague and co-founder of the team of Tacos and Grits, right here, of KTNG860AM.org and KTNG.NetTV, Jeff Jaggers, has also known about this, which he just confirmed it to me as well. Now, after you FB friends and all your audience see this video, I would like to hear your thoughts in pro or con. We need to come up with ideas how to deal with the militarization of occupied racist and fascist apartheid America. Power to all oppressed people of occupied America, EF Mohammed Martinez, racist xenophobe, America's worst nightmare. Let the world know. Háganle saber al mundo. Now, this video, in all fairness, was furnished with, by one of my fellow Facebook friends. And if you want to see this video, please go to my Facebook. Capital E period, small F period, Mohammed, M-O-H-A-2-M-E-D, Martinez. You got to see this video.
M-O-U-S-E. Anyway. We'll be back after this.
You're despicable.
I know I'm despicable. That's why I have the job of general manager.
Oh, jeez. And we're getting ready to do a little welcome.
The question is there a solution for communities to be actively involved and preparing for shit like this and making sure that they're ready? Then 3, 2, 1, and we're back! Oh, God. Ooh, that was pretty good.
Bender.
Lots of french fries. Okay, and part two of this whole thing, and again, you know, there's no problem in burning stuff and looting in response to centuries of brutality.
Bang, baby, bang!
Okay, so let's look at what we can do to change the playing field. Now, this was relayed to me by my Facebook war correspondent, Tabaka Amira Shakur. I love that she finds the 110% value of information that can be called the question. It can be called the question because, therefore, it is something that you can actually use. I lifted this from her, from the Community Solutions Center for Responsive Black Governance, and reworded it so the bulk of you can understand how to take and use power responsibly. First step one. Take steps to control the properties in your communities. That means buy the land taxes underneath the house so you're not affected by the 1998 laws of government-controlled eminent domain practices that route you off and out of your property and then know who's on or form a block association. Set up your watch systems with technology. There's no reason not to set up your own electronic surveillance systems. Anyone can do that. Number two, begin militaristic field training of the community with volunteer security forces. This can be supported by the community small business infrastructure. They can do so. They can do that by donating. Okay. Number three, don't claim territory until it has been fought and secured from the enemy. When there is a visible post, don't give the enemy a Coptic notice of who controls what and where. Be discreet in your guerrilla warfare. That means don't tag the goddaggone buildings up with, oh, MS-13 or the 60th Street or whatever, you know, that sort of thing. Okay, number four, community leaders need to convene and disseminate Google mapped info. Mark your turf and send that as a PDF, or create a flyer that the community can acknowledge and respond to from clearly marked areas and vehicles that are allowed to do so. There's more than one way to denote your turf. Number five, create a war council that doesn't use the internet. Information on secret targets should be relayed by hand-to-hand and timed by payphone. When those targets need to be hit, synchronize timing every 24 hours to effectively carry out those missions and meetings. Number six, within every war council, create a reconciliation board that will help squash gang beef and unify them against the common oppressor. Number seven, he who has more than an acre of land can parcel it to the community for supplies. By making these routable centers for sustainable supplies, crop rotation will keep spoilage down and stock high. Can you dig it? Number eight, community first responders are already in the street. Therefore, you will need to cache operatives. That store weapons, field tech, first aid kits, tear gas, repellent spray, baton shields made out of old oil drums, all hidden and relayed for distribution by headcount at the last minute when armed responses are apparent from law enforcement. Number nine, to create a communications infrastructure, use the obvious. Dog walkers and churchgoers can pass information far more effectively because it's perceived as a peaceful activity. Be creative and change the game up ever so often. Change it up. Number 10, paper trail your heads of state. Don't go to the middleman. All you're going to do, or going to get, really, is the same song and dance. Number 11, Pyradio can broadcast mobily from anywhere and can send encryption-based information or code to any other communities that are nationally held down in American apartheid. Be seditious, not solicitous. You ask for a strategy, you have one. Now, let's see who's lazy or who comes up to the table begging for scraps.
You forgot to add one more thing. Call in all veterans who have been in combat or had training in the military to help train your community in self-defense tactics. You know, the training that we got in the military, because my brother here is a former Marine and I am a veteran as well. And the thing about it is that the training that we got in the military, we should pass that on to our volunteers in our community. Train our people. You know, we must organize self-defense forces. That's how the Black Panther Party started, self-defense forces.
You heard it live, people. We'll be back after this.
¿Cómo explicar que cambió mi corazón? ¿Cómo decirte que ya estás en mi interior? ¿Cómo explicarte que en mí la soledad ha quedado atrás?
And in 3, 2, 1, and we're back. PSAs for the evening. PSAs, the Latino Chamber of Commerce of Compton is basically holding a first-time homebuyers workshop. So please call 424-702-6202. Again, that's 424-702-6202, and ask for Maria. She knows a great deal about this. It's great information, and not only that, but it will also help you if you're a first-time home buyer, get into that house that you're looking for, because Compton is a model city that can be very, very, it can be a very, very good place for homesteaders, or, you know, in keeping, you know, the, you know, keeping the area alive and everything.
Maria de Arreal is the president of the Chamber of Commerce. She's very much involved in trying to make her, she's making her all the attempts to make Compton a better community for all. And the Latino Chamber of Commerce is a inclusive. Don't let the Latino Chamber of Commerce name fool you, because this organization, you know, incorporates anybody, black and brown, and especially black and brown business people.
And speaking of small businesses, okay, if you're a small business and you want to promote on a budget, we do have space available on the radio station, and also we can do filming this too. You can get sponsored airtime for your small business, 8 hours of high traffic, 5 days a week, 24 hours a day. It's a tax write-off. Air your daily, weekly, monthly promos through us. It's a lot cheaper than broadcast regular radio, and a lot cheaper than the newspaper, and it's a hell of a lot cheaper than you going, you know, Markey's and putting it on cardboard. But we'll record and produce your specials on the fly, $150 for 3 months with renewable options, so therefore you can go every 3 months, and then after that we offer you a year, and you can do whatever you want in that particular point. But if you become a member of the Latino Chamber of Commerce of Compton, each member receives a $30 discount. So use the promo code LCCC1 through our website, which is KTNG860AM.org. And
I want to bring out the good news that we are adding one community reporter out of Compton, you know, La Maestra of Compton, and she is going to be our new contributing news writer, news reporter. So, Maestra, welcome to KTNG as part of our staff.
Yay!
Órale, pues! Give him hell, compañera.
You didn't clap.
All right.
Clap louder.
All right, like a good seal.
Yeah. Okay, cool.
Okay, Maria. Hey, bienvenida, okay? Right. Anybody out there interested in being a contributor to our radio station? And we also have KTNG.NetTV. So we need people out there in the community who would like to get involved. They're more than welcome.
Come on in and volunteer.
Anybody.
We include
anybody.
There you go. Now say bye. Say goodnight, Grace.
Adios. What do you mean, Grace, cabrón? This has been Mohamed Martinez, a.k.a. Tacos con Mucho Chile, and
Grace. That's right. The man who does everything. Even I scratch my butt on occasions.
Not me.
That's right, because I got to shake my hands with it later.
Como chingas.
You've just listened to the Compton Weekly Editorial of Community News from your station KTNG 860 AM, the American Militants on the Digital Dial. This is a public-supported sponsorship, and we encourage our listener supporters to stop by our Facebook page or website and leave us a message or much-needed donation. We have to do for ourselves, and to keep real public radio alive and accessible for all, helps develop accredited programs of apprenticeship in the media arts. Teaching a career skill set that isn't entertainment requires the full support of the community, so please make a kind donation. Thank you for listening, and enjoy your day. This is KTNG 860 AM. And nah, we didn't do that. That wasn't us.
In fact, I think we'd be fooling ourselves if we had an audience this large and didn't realize that there were some enemies present. This afternoon, we want to talk about the ballot or the bullet. The ballot or the bullet explains itself. But before we get into it, since this is the year of the ballot or the bullet, I would like to clarify some things that refer to me personally concerning my own personal position. Mm-hmm.